All right, today we're going to do chapter 6, quantitative relations in chemistry. This chapter begins the trend in the course towards quantitative things. So chapter 6, 7, 8, and 9 are all very highly quantitative. Chapter 12, the last one we do, will be a nice departure. It's organic and biochemistry. Very fun. But the next group of chapters are going to be very quantitative things. Here we're going to talk about chemical equations, their stoichiometry, and how we can use the stoichiometry to predict how much of a given product we should obtain. Let's start back at our beginning. We've seen this before. This is aluminum reacting with bromine. Remember, bromine is Br2 to give aluminum bromide. If we write a chemical equation for this, it would be something like this, a symbol for aluminum. Again, S means solid. Br2 is a liquid. And AOBr3 is also a solid. Now, as we look at this equation, we note that it's not quite balanced, is it? Because the reaction arrow has the same properties as an equal sign, we must have the same numbers and types of atoms on both sides, and also the same mass in reactants as we have in products. In order to do this, we're going to insert coefficients. Coefficients in front of these guys that will allow us to balance this equation. Now, we talked about this in chapter 5. If I was to look at this and balance it the way we talked about, first thing I would notice is we have an odd number of bromines here, that's 3, and only 2 on this side, that's even. I think one of the simplest ways is to start off by trying to make everything either odd or even. We can do this by putting a 2 in front of the aluminum bromide. This now gives us 6 bromines on this side, and it's even. But we only have 2 on this side, so we would stick a 3 in front of that. Now this works nicely. When we put our 2 here, we have 2 aluminums, only 1 on this side, so we need to double that as well. These coefficients, we said, represent the stoichiometry of this reaction. It's the number of moles of reactants and the number of moles of products. If we were to look at this equation, and we said if we had 2 moles of aluminum and we reacted it with bromine, as long as we have 3 or more moles of bromine, all this aluminum is going to be consumed. If we have more than 3 moles, we say that this is excess bromine. Typically, when you do a reaction, you'll put 1 reactant in excess. It just makes it simpler. So if we had all the bromine in the world it needs, 2 moles of aluminum should give us 2 moles of aluminum bromide. That is the theoretical yield of the reaction. Any questions on the concept? Simply looking at the stoichiometry here, looking at the coefficients, we can predict the theoretical yield. 2 moles of aluminum, 2 moles of bromide. But what if didn't have 2 moles of aluminum? What if we had a different amount? That's what we're going to do today. Let's look at the reaction of ethanol with oxygen. Ethanol, ethyl alcohol, burns in oxygen to give CO2 and water. Whenever you see an equation, first thing you should do is convince yourself that it is balanced. We have 3, 5, 6 hydrogens. This side we have 3 times 2, 6 hydrogens, 2 carbons. We have 6, 7 oxygens, 1, 2, 3, and then 4 more, 7 oxygens. So we're balanced. Here we're looking at the relationship between CO2 and ethanol. We're saying how much CO2 will we get if we had 2.5 moles of ethanol. Now clearly, if we had 1 mole of ethanol, we would get 2 moles of CO2. Right? That's just the stoichiometry as written. But we don't have 1, we have 2.5. So what we're going to do here, first thing, is to solve this using our given ratio find algorithm. The ratio we're going to use is the stoichiometry from this equation. And it's simply going to be 2 moles of CO2 are going to be formed from 1 mole of ethanol. That's our ratio. Our given here is going to be the fact that we have 2.5 moles of ethanol. And of course, we're trying to find CO2. 1 mole of ethanol yields 2 moles of CO2, given ratio find algorithm. Okay? So our given is our 2.5 moles. Our ratio from the equation, 2 moles of CO2 for every mole of ethanol. Okay, that makes sense. We're trying to find our CO2. When we do something like this, remember, first thing we're going to do is put down our given, then our ratio, and that should give us what we're trying to find. The units of our given moles of ethanol must be in our denominator here. So, we solve it this way. 2.5 moles of ethanol, our ratio, 2 moles of CO2 for every mole of ethanol, and ethanol will cancel, leaving us only with moles of CO2. Now the math is so simple I can do this in my head. 2.5 times 2 divided by 1, 5 moles of CO2. Now all the problems that we're going to work today, you can do using given, ratio, and find. We're going to introduce a slightly different way of setting this up because once you get used to doing it, I think it's faster and easier. It flows better on your calculator, et cetera, et cetera. And this is the two-ratio method. So let's go ahead and redo this problem using two ratios, an unknown and a known. Now the known ratio is what we used before, 2 CO2s for every ethanol. That's given by our equation, right? If we look at our balanced equation here, we first set up our known ratio based on the stoichiometry. So 2 CO2s for every ethanol. Next, we want to just look at the problem. And in the problem, we're going to try to identify what we want to find, and we'll call that X. And then we're going to identify our given and put that in our denominator. So, what we're trying to find here is simply moles of CO2. And that'll be our X. We'll put that in our numerator because both ratios have to be set up the same way. CO2 must be on top, ethanol on the bottom. Our given, as before, is simply 2.5 moles of ethanol. That's our denominator. So we set it up this way, and here are our two ratios, a known and an unknown. Now, they're on your calculator. Where we're going to head, if you were going to solve this, you would simply say, okay, I need to bring my 2.5 over this side. So 2.5 times 2 divided by 1 would be 5. Let's break it down in steps, though, just to make sure we get it. Here, our 2.5, we brought it up from our ratio. Here's our ratio, our known ratio, and this is our X over here. Again, 2.5 times 2 divided by 1. This is exactly the same thing we did in given and ratio, isn't it? Here's our given, here's our ratio, these guys cancel, and we're left with moles of CO2. So it's the same thing. 2 times 2.5 is 5, and that's our answer. So it doesn't matter how you want to do these, but I think the two ratio method actually makes it faster and easier once you get used to it. Any questions? Well, let's do another one. Calcium plus HCl, calcium chloride and hydrogen gas. In lab, we did calcium plus water. Remember that? Got very hot. Well, calcium, of course, reacts with HCl even more vigorously. The fizzing that you see is the evolution of hydrogen gas. Are we balanced? 1 calcium, 1 calcium, 2 chlorines, 2 chlorines, 2 hydrogens, and 2 hydrogens. So yes, we are. That's good. All right. We're looking here at HCl and calcium. That's the pair that you're looking for in your problem. Now, both of these are reactants, but it doesn't matter. All right, HCl and calcium. How many moles of HCl? 3.25 moles of calcium. So we look first at our chemical equation. 1 mole of calcium requires 2 moles of HCl. That's our known ratio, isn't it? 2 HCls for every calcium. Our unknown ratio we're going to get from our problem. So here's our known ratio. 2 HCls. For every calcium. Everyone see that? Now let's look at the problem. What's our unknown? What's the thing we're trying to find? And that's moles of HCl. So that's X. What's our given? We have 3.5 moles of calcium. And that'll be in our denominator. Those two make up the unknown ratio. X moles of HCl, that's this, 3.25 moles of calcium. That's our given. Now, if I saw this and I had my calculator in my hand, I would simply take 3.25 times 2 divided by 1 and get my answer. But again, let's break it down step by step. Multiply both sides by 3.25 moles. Our moles calcium will cancel. And our math, 3.25 times 2 divided by 1, 6.5. Once again, here's our given. Here's our ratio. So you can do these either way. Any questions? All right, let's do one more here. Ethane gas, that's two carbons, six hydrogens, reacts with oxygen to give CO2 and water. First thing you should note here is that no, this is not a balanced equation. So let's think for a second how we're going to balance this. Well, we have six hydrogens here, don't we? We only have two on this side. So, in order to get the same number, I would need to put a 3 out here. Oh, this is hard. So I need to put a 3 out here. We have two carbons here, only one here. So we need to stick a 2 out here. Okay. What have we done to our oxygens now? How many oxygens do we have on this side? 2 times 2 is 4. 3 waters, that's 5, 6, 7. Now, oxygen comes in pairs, doesn't it? O2. So to get 7 oxygens here, we would have to stick in a 3.5. We don't want to do that because we want whole numbers only, right? So, how do we fix this? We actually are going to just double everything. If we double our 3.5, it becomes 7. We have to double the number of ethanes to 2, double our CO2s to 4, and our waters to 6. So when you're solving an equation, and after your first iteration, you wind up with something like this, 3.5, the next step is just to try doubling everything until you get whole numbers. Yep, I got it right. Any questions? Let's look at our problem. In our problem, what are we looking at here? Molecular oxygen, that's O2, and CO2, this guy. So what's our known ratio? 7 O2s to 4 CO2s. 7 to 4 is our ratio. 7 moles of oxygen, 4 moles of CO2. That's our known. Now we look at our problem. What are we trying to find? Because that's X. Moles of molecular oxygen, that's X. What's our given? Our given is simply that. We have 1.7 moles of CO2. So our unknown ratio is going to be X over the given. That's X over 1.7. Now, once again, if I was doing it, I would just take my calculator, do 1.7 times 7 divided by 4, and get the answer. Let's just multiply both sides by 1.7 one more time here. We can show that moles of CO2 will cancel. And again, the math is simply 1.7 times 7 divided by 4. And we get this as my calculator answer. But we're dealing with 3 digits here, right? 3 significant figures. So let's round this. How would we round it? It ends exactly in 5, so we round even. Remember? To 9/8. Any questions? Now, there are 3 tutorials that we will do that accompany this chapter. And I will tell you honestly, they're not entirely trivial. Okay? Previous chapters, they were much simpler. These are not entirely trivial. You're going to have to work at them over and over again until you finally get it. So let's look at one. Here we have an equation. We're starting off with sodium hydrogen carbonate. It's decomposing to give sodium carbonate, CO2, and water. We're looking at a link between sodium hydrogen carbonate and sodium carbonate. So this guy and this guy. We look at our equation. Our known ratio here, that's this guy, is going to be 2 sodium hydrogen carbonates for every carbonate. So 2 to 1, that's this one. Our unknown ratio is simply going to be X over the given. And the given is shown right here, 0.8217 moles of sodium carbonate. So it might look obscure, but it's really simple. Our known ratio, 2 to 1, our unknown, X over the given. Our known ratio here is 2 to 1. Our unknown ratio, this is X, that's what we're trying to find. And here's the given. We simply multiply 0.8217 times 2 divided by 1. And we get 1.643. Any questions? Well, let's do one more, and I'll hush for a second. This is chloroethane reacting with oxygen to give CO2, water, and chlorine. And we're looking for the relationship between chloroethane and chlorine. So start off by writing the known ratio.
chloroethane and chlorine.
Chlorine is here, chloroethane is there, 4 moles of chloroethane give 2 moles of chlorine. That's our known ratio. Write the unknown ratio. That's simply what you're trying to find, moles of chloroethane, that's X, over the given, 0.9922. So hopefully you wrote something like this, chloroethane over chlorine is 4 to 2. That's the known. The unknown is what we're trying to find. This is X. This is our given. 0.9922 times 4 divided by 2 is 1.98. So the tutorial might look challenging, but if you simply keep in mind that you want to make these two ratios, look at the stoichiometry. This defined is going to be X, and this is our given. Known ratio, unknown ratio. Any questions? All right. Well, what if I was to ask you in this problem, instead of giving me the number of moles of chloroethane, what if I asked you to give me the number of grams of chloroethane? Well, you can do that because you can easily convert moles into grams using the molar mass. But there's actually a simpler way using something called the mass ratio. So let's take a look at that. Here we have zinc sulfide reacting with oxygen to give zinc oxide and SO2. If you read your problem, we want to know how many grams of zinc oxide, that's this stuff, we get when we have 25 grams of zinc sulfide. Now, you know, this is a little bit more like real life. If you were in lab, you would weigh out 25 grams of something, do a reaction, and see how many grams of product you have, right? So this is a little bit closer to real life. We're going to approach the problem the same way. We're going to make our known ratio in terms of moles, but then we're going to convert it into what's known as a mass ratio. So let's see how we do that. According to our equation, a stoichiometry here between zinc sulfide and zinc oxide is 2 to 2, but that's the same thing as 1 to 1, isn't it? So you could put 2 to 2 if you want, doesn't matter. But let's just do 1 to 1 because it's simpler. Our unknown here is going to be the mass of zinc oxide, and our known is going to be, or our given, is the mass of zinc sulfide. So, here's our simple mole ratio, 1 to 1. Okay? We go to the periodic table. We look up the mass of zinc, the mass of sulfur, the mass of oxygen. And we calculate our molar masses. Now, we know that for zinc sulfide, 97.46 grams is the same thing, exactly the same, as 1 mole, isn't it? And 81 grams of zinc oxide is the same as 1 mole of zinc oxide. So instead of making a mole ratio this way, I can do it directly just by writing that. 97 grams of zinc sulfide is the same as 1 mole. And 81 grams of zinc oxide, again, is the same as 1 mole. So I can simply substitute molar masses instead of my moles. All right, that's kind of cute. Let's finish the problem with our unknown ratio. Our X is going to be grams of zinc oxide. We want that actually, because of the way I set up the ratio, this is going to have to be in the denominator. Because remember, they have to match. Our given is going to be our 25 grams of zinc sulfide. So again, because I wrote it this way, I've got to write my known ratio the same way, sulfide over oxide. Whenever I do that, it makes me very upset because by symmetry, I really like X on the top. So what do? I simply flip them both over. It's entirely legal mathematically. Flip one side, flip the other. You don't have to, of course, but I just think it makes it easier in my head, again, if X is on the top. So if you ever are working a problem like this and you come up with a reversal, let's go. So you write it this way. All you have to do is simply flip it over. Now, as we said, the calculator stuff, I would just look at this and say 25 times 81.83 divided by 97.46. Very simple on your calculator. And you should get about 20.9. Any questions? Kind of a neat trick, isn't it? Sticking in the masses instead of the number of moles. Now with this problem, our ratio here was 1:1, wasn't it? What do you do if the ratio isn't 1:1? So let's look at another problem. Here we're taking fluorine, reacting it with water. We're going to make hydrogen fluoride and oxygen. Okay. We're looking at grams again. Grams of water, this guy, and grams of HF, this guy. So the ratio we want, the relationship we're after, is between water and HF. Two waters, four HF. That's our known ratio, isn't it? Two waters, four HF. Two moles of water, four moles of HF. Let's start off by writing our known molar ratio. That's 2 to 4. Now we want this in grams. So 2 moles of water is the same as how many grams? This is the molar mass, isn't it? If we multiply this by 2, 36 grams would be 2 moles of water. Likewise, HF is 20. 4 moles of HF is the same as 80. So, we're simply going to multiply these by the molar masses. 2 times 18, 4 times 20. The coefficient times the molar mass. Now you don't have to multiply these all out, but I did. 2 times 18 is going to be 36-ish, 4 times 20 about 80-ish. All these moles cancel, and we're left with 36 over 80. This, again, is our mass ratio. If you have more than 1 mole, all you have to do is multiply the number of moles, the stoichiometry coefficient, 2 and 4, by the molar mass. Another way, a simpler way to think about this in terms of real life. If we have 36 grams of water, this tells us we will get 80 grams of HF. 36 grams of water gives us 80 grams of HF. Real life. Any questions? All right. This is what we're trying to find, grams of water. That's our X, right? Our given here is our 62 grams of HF. Our unknown ratio is simply going to be X over given. And this is what we have. X over our given. And here's our mass ratio. On your magic calculator, all you have to do is punch in 62.4 times 36.04 divided by 80.04, and you get 28.1. Any questions? All right, there's a tutorial, of course. We have a balanced equation here. We're looking for how many grams of cobalt 2 oxide. Cobalt 2. If we have 40.9 grams of cobalt 3 oxide. So our link here is between cobalt 2, that's this guy, and cobalt 3, that's this guy. Go ahead and write the known ratio. That's this guy, stoichiometric coefficient. No ratio. 4 of these gives 2 of these. Four moles of cobalt 2, 2 moles of cobalt 3. Now, to convert this to mass, we simply want to take and multiply each of these by the molar mass. Molar mass here is 74.9, here is 165.8. I've just shown it this way. 4 times 74.9, 2 times 165.8. That's a ratio. Now you can multiply it out if you want, you don't have to, but you could. Now our unknown ratio is going to be what we're trying to find, that's x, divided by our given. If we do this using given multiplied by the ratio, it's even simpler, I think. Our given here would be 165.8, and this is our ratio. So let's look at that. Here's our given. Here's what we're trying to find. That's x. And here's just our ratio. So what do you do on your calculator? 40.9 times 4 times 74.9 divided by 2 divided by 165.8. And you get about 37. Step one, get your mole ratio. Step two, multiply the coefficients by the molar mass. That's our mass ratio. Step three, multiply the mass ratio by the given, and you got your problem. Everyone see that? I hope. Any questions? All right. As I said way back at the start, if we took 2 moles of aluminum and reacted it with all the bromine in the world, we would get 2 moles of aluminum bromide. Right? Now what that kind of tells you is that the thing that limits how much product you get is the one that's in the smallest molar quantity. That limits it. This is the concept of limiting reactants. Limiting reactants can be really complicated. We're not going to be complicated. Wait till general chemistry, we can blow you away with it. Yeah, but just look at the concept. If you had 2 moles of aluminum, you would get 2 moles of product. If we had 1.5 moles of aluminum, you'd get 1.5 moles of product. Aluminum limits how much stuff you can make. Simpler way is to think of gloves. It's been chilly in the mornings. If you have kids, you might say, oh, gotta put gloves on them. You open the closet, you see a pile. Okay. As you go through the pile, we see we have 4 left-handeds with only 3 right-handeds. Okay, so you go here and you start. There's a pair. Dig down. There's another pair. Dig down. There's another pair. And we're left with 1 left-handed leftover. The thing that limits how many pairs is how many right-handed gloves we had. That is our limiting reactant. Any questions? Now let's look at basically a cartoon here and convert this to chemistry. Fluorine and chlorine react to give chlorine trifluoride. 3 moles of fluorine, 1 mole of chlorine. So what if I tell you we had this sample of chlorine, the green guys, and fluorine, the yellows? How much chlorine trifluoride could we make? Well, look at your ratio here. Every mole of chlorine, that's one of these, gives 2 chlorine trifluorides. But every mole of chlorine requires 3 moles of fluorine. So, this guy right here, Cl2, would require 1, 2, 3 fluorines. This one, Cl2, would require 1, 2, 3 moles of fluorine. So with this guy, but we're out. We're out of fluorine, aren't we? So when the reaction's done, 6 atoms of chlorine, that's these guys, require 18 fluorines, but we only had 12. So we have 4 moles of product, and we have this 4 fluorine left over. What is limiting? The amount of fluorine limits how much product we can make. We don't have enough. What's in excess? Chlorine. We have some left over. So this is the concept of limiting reactants. When you have something like this and you're given molar quantities, you can look at the reaction and say which reactant is limiting. In this case, fluorine. We don't have enough fluorine. We need 3 of them for every chlorine. And that makes chlorine in excess. Now, last time I taught 110, I put this question on your second exam. Same equation. Fluorine plus chlorine, chlorine trifluoride. I say we have 9 moles of fluorine, 3 moles of chlorine in our mixture. Which of these is correct? Excess of chlorine. Excess of fluorine. Fluorine is limiting. Or A and C are both correct. E is all of the reactants have been consumed.
Think about the answer for a minute.
We have 3 moles of chlorine here, don't we? So 3 of these guys. Every chlorine requires how many moles of fluorine? 3. So if we have 3 moles here, we need 9 moles here. What are we given? 3 moles and 9 moles. By gosh, it works, doesn't it? All of the reactants have been consumed. Any questions? Real test question. I assure you, you'll see some variant of this in a while. All right, remember, we were talking about theoretical yield. We said that when we do all the operations we've been doing, what we're really calculating is the theoretical yield for a reaction. Let's go ahead and look at this a little more closely, and then we're going to introduce the concept that chemistry is imperfect, and we don't always get the theoretical yield. So let's just go back and look at a couple examples here. Once again, we said if we had two aluminums, we get two aluminum bromides. That is our theoretical yield. If we had one aluminum, we could get one aluminum bromide. That's our theoretical yield. Our ratio here, we learned how to do this. Bromine to aluminum bromide, 3:2. If we had 3 moles of bromine and excess aluminum, we would get 2 moles of aluminum bromide. So this is what we've been doing. Simply theoretical yields. What if I take chloroacetic acid, react it with oxygen? I can make CO2, water, and HCl. Okay. How many moles of oxygen reacted, that's this stuff, with 0.26 moles, if 0.26 moles of carbon monoxide was formed? So another way to say this is, we have 0.26 moles of carbon monoxide formed in our reaction. How many moles of oxygen were consumed? What's the theoretical link between the two? Well, we look at our equation. Again, we're looking at oxygen and CO. So it's 1:4, isn't it? 1 mole of oxygen, 4 moles of CO. So go ahead, write your known ratio in moles. Known ratio, 1:02, 4 COs. What's our unknown here? What are we trying to find?
Oxygen.
Moles of oxygen, that's our X. What's our given? 0.26 moles of carbon monoxide. So this over this is our unknown ratio. Once again on your calculator, 0.2645 times 1 divided by 4. Oh, we get a number with lots of digits on your calculator. How do we round this? Again, to 4 digits. How do we round it? It ends in a 5. We round even. So the 2 stays. So saying this another way, theoretically, 0.06 moles of oxygen gives 0.26 moles of carbon monoxide. That's our theoretical yield. Now let's do one more of these. You can take boric acid, heat it up, dehydrate it, make a dehydroborate, and liberate water. We've done that kind of reaction. how many grams of dehydroborate will we get if we add 36 grams of boric acid? So our link here is going to be between boric acid and the dehydrated borate. So step one, write your ratio. Six moles of boric acid, one mole of the dehydrated. But everything here is in grams, isn't it? So convert this now to a mass ratio. For the mass ratio, we simply want to take our boric acid, multiply it by 61, this guy. For this, we want to take our dehydrated times 244. When we multiply these all out, again, what do we tell ourselves? If we had 370 grams of boric acid, we would get 245 grams of the dehydrated stuff. Okay? Now, what's our given? 36 grams of our boric acid. We're trying to find how much dehydrated stuff. So we simply plug those in here as our unknown ratio. And the calculations, in spite of the fact that their calculations are really simple, aren't they? 36 times 244 divided by 370, about 24 grams of stuff. This, once again, is our theoretical yield. If everything in chemistry worked perfectly, you would wind up with 24 grams of product. I assure you, however, if you do this in lab, you're not going to get 24 grams. Something's going to go wrong. Sometimes it's because your lab partner sneezed and blew the stuff all over the table. Sometimes it's just the nature of chemistry. There are what are called side reactions that occur. Now in the lab, next Tuesday, we're going to do empirical formula of magnesium oxide. Kind of a neat lab, actually. You get to burn magnesium ribbon, kind of neat. But there's a side reaction. Magnesium doesn't just react with oxygen, it can also react with nitrogen. And so we get a mixture of products and we have to fix that. Okay? Side reactions can happen. That means that quite often, instead of the theoretical yield, you will get some percentage of what you're supposed to get. The theoretical yield is what we calculated in our stoichiometry. We've done that all day. We're good at it now. The actual yield, well, that's what you actually get. You do the analysis and you say, gee, this is what I got. The percentage yield is simply actual divided by theoretical times 100. That makes it a percentage. Think about popcorn.
Okay, this is popcorn.
If you count quickly, there are 20 kernels of popcorn here, right? I'm going to take these, put them in my popper, and let them pop. When it's all done, I dump it out, and I look and I say, well, 16 of them popped and 4 didn't. Now our theoretical yield here is what? 20. We should get 20. We got 16. So what's our percentage yield? 16 divided by 20 times 100, 80% yield. Simple concept. Actual yield over theoretical times 100. Now let's do this in chemistry. Aluminum plus sulfur gives aluminum sulfide. Fun reaction, actually. 5 moles of sulfur. Here. We calculate the way we have all day, we should get 1.7 moles of product. When we're all done, we gather up our product and weigh it. And by gosh, we only got 1.5 moles. What's the percent yield? Go ahead, set up the calculation. Our actual is 1.5, our theoretical is 1.7. Multiply by 100. (1.5 / 1.7 × 100) 88%. Any questions? Let's kind of combine everything we know here and do a percentage yield problem. If we take nitrogen monoxide reacted with oxygen, we can make 2 NO2s. We're going to take 10 grams of NO. When we do that, we wind up with 9.7 grams of NO2. Now, if you look at the stoichiometry here, it's 1-to-1. We could set up a known ratio and an unknown ratio, make a mass ratio out of it. But actually, there's an even simpler way to do this. For both of these, we can calculate the molar mass, can't we? Nitrogen plus oxygen. We have a mass up here, and we have a molar mass. What is mass divided by molar mass? We say it every night before we go to bed. Mass divided by molar mass is moles. So if we simply do this division, we get moles of NO and moles of NO2. They should be the same. Let's see if they are. 10 grams divided by our molar mass of 29.99 is how many moles? 0.33. We got 9.7 grams of NO2. Molar mass is about 46. Divide these out. How many moles? 2.21.
Quickly calculate the percentage yield. What was the actual yield?
0.21.
What should we get?
0.33, because they're the same.
So 0.21 divided by 0.33,
we should get 0.33, we get 0.21. Simply divide these, multiply by 100.
This reaction went in 63% yield.
Any questions? Now the third tutorial for this chapter deals with percentage yield calculations. So let's take a look.
This really combines everything together that we've talked about today. We're dealing in grams. We have a balanced equation. We have our molar masses. What we're going to do is write a mole ratio, convert it to a mass ratio. Then we're going to calculate the theoretical yield. Then we're going to read our problem and see that we only got 6.6 grams of stuff. That's the actual yield. And from those two, we will calculate the percentage yield. So everything we've learned today in one problem. Let's see, we're looking at trifluoroethane and CO. Trifluoroethane and CO. What's the mole ratio?
1 to 2.
Since we're looking for yield of CO, we'll do 2 to 1. 1 mole of this gives 2 moles of that. We'll write the mole ratio, then the mass ratio, take our given, and calculate the theoretical yield. That's our plan. Step one, here's our mole ratio, 2 to 1, right? We know our molar masses, 28 and 84. Multiply these together, and we get our mass ratio. Every 84 grams of this should give us 56 grams of that. That's what a mass ratio tells you. All right, we are trying to find grams of CO, right? That's our X. Our given here is 15.6. So if we take 15.6 grams of this stuff, multiply it by a ratio, we get grams of CO. Again, we've done this over and over again. We know how to do this. Multiply it out, 15 times 56 divided by 84, about 10.4 grams. That is our theoretical yield. If everything worked, that's what we would get. So, our theoretical yield is 10.4.
Our actual yield is given in the problem of 6.6. Calculate percent yield.
Actual
divided by theoretical times 100. Six divided by 10.4 times 100, 63.8%. Any questions? All right, when you do this tutorial, you will get at least two versions. Okay? You'll get this guy. And again, this is everything we've done today. This is the whole chapter. And you will also get one where you are given a percent yield. You're told what the percentage yield is. And you have to calculate the actual yield. How do you do that? Simply take our percentage yield, in this case 63, we have to divide by 100 now, that's 0.63 times our theoretical to get what you've got. So let's look at a problem. Here we have 49 grams of carbon in 48.8% yield, making carbon monoxide. What we have to do here is figure out our theoretical yield, get the theoretical yield to CO, then we're going to multiply it by 0.48. to get the actual yield. So to get our theoretical yield, we look at our mass ratio here. 5 carbons, 4 COs, right? Four COs for 5 carbons. Every CO weighs 28. Every carbon weighs 12. We multiply them out to get a mass ratio. 60 grams of carbon gives us 112 grams of CO. Our given here is 49.6 grams of carbon. So we're going to multiply our given times the ratio. Carbon will cancel, and we're left with grams of CO. So our theoretical yield is going to be 49.6 times 112 divided by 60, or about 92.5 grams. That is our theoretical yield. Now we know that our actual yield is only 48%. So, this is our percentage yield. So to get the actual yield, we want to take our theoretical, multiply it by 0.488 to get the actual. 0.488, this guy divided by 100, times our theoretical gives the actual about 45.2 grams. Any questions? This one tutorial here, especially the other version, really wraps up the entire chapter. So work at this because it's what's going to get you there. What we have so far in terms of tutorials for these last two chapters
are balancing oxidation numbers, redox reactions. Today we did stoichiometry, mass ratios, and percentage yield. 5 points each. I understand and I admit, I empathize. The tutorials are getting much more difficult. So is the material. But that's just the way chemistry goes. What can I say? That's what makes it fun. Any questions? When you do your tutorials, please never ever use Internet Explorer for anything, anything at all. Number two, some people are having trouble with Firefox even. Don't use an old version of Firefox. Chrome or Safari seem to work perfectly. Okay? If you have not handed in your lab sheet, please do before you go.